side of life.
Yes. Good morning, Austin, and welcome to the Atheist Experience. That's a Monty Python's always a good way to start the day there. This is coming to you live August 12th, right?
By my calculations, yeah.
Yes, just making sure I had the right day. That is our telephone number. We'll be taking your calls live on the air. Let me reintroduce myself. I'm sorry. This is Ray Blevins, my co-host Jeff D., and this week's guest, Don Rhoades. I would like to start off with announcements of Atheist Community of Austin. We meet every Sunday down at the Hot Jumbo Bakery, which is down West 5th and Lavaca. And today is a board meeting. So we'd like to make sure, remind all the board members to please come on down. We'll have the board meeting a few minutes after the general meeting breaks up. And we got several things we need to take care of today, so we'd definitely like to see all the board members there. That's all the announcements I can think of for our Atheist Community of Austin. What I'm thinking is we'll go ahead and go to the news.
Okay.
And then we'll come back and we'll do a little bit review of our guest speaker, Steven Weinberg, who did such a great job and had such a great turnout. We definitely want to do some reviews on that.
Yeah, that was excellent. I enjoyed that his talk last week a lot. The rapture came and all I got was this crummy t-shirt. Four separate groups predicted that the rapture would happen yesterday, September 11, 1999. Jan Weaver Gindoff used the reign of Uzziah as a parallel of modern Israel to arrive at a date 51 years after the founding of Israel as a possible time for the rapture. Rosh Hashanah, which equates to sundown, September 11, 1999, will be the year 6001, according to scholar Michael Rood. That's the Jewish year 6001. An error was introduced in the Jewish calendar, he claims, which makes the generally accepted date off by several years. This will be the great and notable day of the Lord. Although he didn't predict the actual rapture on this date, he claims that that this day will see the beginning of bloodshed, plagues, and all matter of pestilence, followed at some unspecified time by the coming of the Messiah. And of course, these were written before yesterday, so we're talking about September the 11th, which was yesterday. Jason Hommel was amazed to find that there are 5,760 grains of gold in a troy pound. Coupling this with the amazing fact that the number of faces, sides, and vertices of a cube can be multiplied by 576, he got a clear indication that the Jewish year 5,760, 1999, this would be the one that's not miscalculated by several years like the last guy was saying, will see the rapture of the church. Jason went on to say, the associative thought processes that lead one to accomplish rational thinking and figuring were completely absent from this process. A truer word was never spoken. Bonnie Gaunt and Ron Reese, denizens of the Marantha Ministries, built upon the Bible codes, absolutely unbroken record of no hits, to cast their rapture vote for Rosh Hashanah 1999, again, yesterday. Some were also predicting that the rapture would happen on September 9, 1999, that's 9-9-99, maybe at 9:09 a.m. or 9:09 p.m., but that didn't happen either. The next scheduled rapture that we know of is slated for September 23, according to one Nostradamus worshiper. There's also a standing prediction of the arrival of the King of Terror Comet Lee, also inspired by Nostradamus's insipid ramblings, at some unspecified time during this month, rescheduled from early predictions that had it arriving in July. We'll keep you posted and let you know the minute anything actually happens. Yes, right.
May I put an invitation out there to our viewers that anyone that would like to make their own prediction on the rapture, and we'll have it here recorded for history. We'd love to hear your prediction.
Yeah, but
now.
Oh, go ahead, Arlo.
Now.
Oh, now. you're wrong.
Nope, wrong. Southern Baptists attack Jews during high holidays. Fort Worth Southern Baptists are asking members to pray that Jews will convert to Christianity this month during Rosh Hashanah, again yesterday, the Jewish New Year, and Yom Kippur, the Jewish Day of Atonement. Rosh Hashanah was yesterday, and Yom Kippur is September 20th, with both celebrations beginning at sundown the day before. A prayer guide published and distributed by the Southern Baptist International Mission Board in Richmond, Virginia, explained that Jewish High Holy Days gives sketches of Jewish people in different parts of the world, and offers suggestions on how to pray for Jewish people. The guide urges Baptists to, quote, pray for Jewish individuals that you know by name. Some Jewish leaders described the action as arrogant and offensive. Baptists have a right to believe what they believe, said Mark Briskman, Southwest Regional Director for the Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith. But we find this offensive. It shows an element of arrogance because they are specifically targeting Jews during their holy season. Kansas's colleges troubled as state schools are allowed to stop teaching evolution. With Kansas public schools now permitted to wipe the theory of evolution out of their science curricula, higher education leaders in the state said they planned to educate the public about what they see as the dangers of the policy, rather than changing their training programs for prospective science teachers. Even so, some college science professors report that the State Board of Education's decision, although limited to public elementary and secondary schools, has already hurt efforts to recruit faculty members. And lawmakers are scrambling to find ways to make sure that the science courses of Kansas high school graduates aren't laughed off by college admissions counselors nationwide. Saying they are embarrassed by the evolution vote, Governor Bill Graves, a Republican, and many legislators want to put even more pressure on local school districts. State Representative David Adkins, also a Republican, said last month he plans to introduce legislation that would require high school students to study evolution in order to be admitted to the state's public universities. It's one way we can maintain the academic viability of Kansas students, Mr. Adkins said of the proposal, which Governor Graves said he would support if it passes the legislature. It's inexcusable that the board, in its actions, undermined the future of Kansas students. Some faculty members said the board's ruling also undermined their ability to attract top-notch professors to the state. Gary W. Conrad, a distinguished biology professor at Kansas State, said that he had received dozens of responses to more than 200 letters he sent out at the beginning of August seeking nominations for two science positions. But after the board's ruling, he received only one response, a letter from Maxine F. Singer, president of the Carnegie Institution in Washington. In the letter, Ms. Singer wrote that she would not recommend that anyone accept a biology position in Kansas. Quote, the students who come to Kansas State University will not have had the appropriate preparation in biology in high school to undertake serious study, she wrote. Moreover, anyone taking a job as a professor at the university will likely have problems of various kinds that stem from the general attitude in the state. Science professors with young children could be particularly difficult to attract to Kansas, Mr. Conrad added. Why would any faculty member want to come to a place to have their kids educated in a primitive education system, he asked. School districts that adopt creationism curriculum could face the same recruitment problem, said Mr. Staver, the director of the science education program at Kansas State. The university has the largest teacher education program in the state and annually graduates some 30 science teachers. He said that he would advise job seekers to avoid districts where creationism is endorsed. He said he won't let the board's policy influence his own teaching.
That's fantastic, and I hope it becomes a big issue during the election there.
Yeah. Congratulations, fundamentalists. You won one, and now you've got egg all over your faces. School district sued for closing on Jewish High Holy Days. All kinds of stuff really did happen on the 11th, but none of it happened to involve any Christians being wafted away to Happy Land. In Cincinnati, a suburban school district's practice of closing for the Jewish High Holy Days is being challenged in a federal court as a violation of the constitutional separation of church and state. The American Civil Liberties Union filed a lawsuit in U.S. District Court against Sycamore School District on August 25, the first day of school in the district that serves the towns of Montgomery and Blue Ash. The true motivation for the board's calendar decision to close on the Jewish High Holy Days, but not on the holy days of other faiths, was the defendant's desire to favor Judaism over other religious faiths, the lawsuit says. Public schools may close on religious holidays only if they have a religiously neutral reason for doing so, said Gino Scarcelli, associate legal director for the ACLU of Ohio. Stigmata. The new film Stigmata raises questions about Christian dogma, but is ultimately a portrayal of an atheist becoming a believer. Patricia Arquette plays central character Frankie Page. She said, quote, "It was a very interesting character, and it was interesting for me because I really believe in God. To play an atheist, it felt very dangerous and naughty to me." Unquote. In the film, Frankie develops stigmata, mysteriously appearing wounds imitating those supposedly suffered by Jesus on the cross, and experiences a wide range of spectacular supernatural phenomena, which merely highlights the flaw in the film's reasoning. The reason that there are atheists is that stuff like that simply doesn't happen in real life. Stigmata opened nationwide on Friday, September 10. It runs 102 minutes and is rated R for sequences of violence, strong language, and sexual content. Yet another indication of the lengths to which theists will go to try to sucker in atheists. And that's the news.
Well, I appreciate that. And,
there was one other thing I wanted to talk about before I finish. I don't actually have anything written up on it. But for those of you who have been following this unfolding story in Killeen with the Wiccans who are practicing their worship on the army base at Fort Hood,
There
was a march against Wicca. I think it was called the March Against Wickedness, is how it was portrayed, by a local fundamentalist minister, his family, and a smattering of his followers. That word of that impending march got out, and what happened was when that gang of protesters arrived at the bookstores that they were going to picket, bookstores that sell Wiccan books to Wiccans, they ran into a crowd of Wiccans and atheists and other Christians who were counter-protesting them. And some people from our own group were there, and there was discussion of this over email. So that apparently went off real well.
Well, fantastic. Remind everyone, this is... I think I said August earlier, didn't I? It's September 12th.
If you said August and I agreed with you, then I was also wrong.
I just realized that. I did
it's September.
I didn't think I said October 12th.
Those Jewish people watching the show will realize this because they'll know that I was full of it when I said yesterday was Rosh Hashanah if it was August.
Yes. Today is September 12th, and we will be taking phone calls live on the air. We'll be talking about the rapture. If anybody wants to make predictions about the rapture or have their viewpoints on that, we'd like to hear. You were telling you did bring in some news of the weird. Did you like to share with us?
I sure did. And before I get to that, I'd just like to mention that that opening tune, that clever, funny tune, is the finale of Life of Brian, Monty Python film, which may be the best film ever made. If you're an atheist, it's real interesting. You watch it with another atheist. This from last week's News of the Weird. Debtors Norman and Melissa Cameron said in court documents that God told them they didn't have to pay their mortgage. That's from Hartford, Connecticut in August. Dean William Trammell, 22, charged with assaulting a flight attendant.
We're just getting word here that we can't hear you.
Mics with him. We can't pick him up. Change mics or something.
Hang on.
Find out which one you're on.
He's on 5.
We could hear you just barely, though, through everybody else's mic.
There you go.
Okay.
Try again.
All righty. Dean William Trammell, 22, charged with assaulting a flight attendant, said God told him he didn't have to remain seated during the landing. That's from Baltimore in January. And Priscilla Lee Jansma, 44, arrested for killing her husband, told police, "Jesus told me it was okay to do it." And that was from Aurora, Colorado. We also had a real... a spirited letter in the American Statesman last week about religious theology. What's so bad about the good book, Life and Arts, August 31? Perhaps the good book is not so good. Adam and Eve ate an apple, and God was so outraged he cursed them and all of their descendants. A perfect blood offering was needed to pay for this wicked sin, so God impregnated a teen virgin who delivered a sinless son. When the descendants killed God's only begotten son, God was appeased. He resurrected his son and forgave everyone. When many reject the authority and redemption in the blood of his son, God then gets so angry he destroys the earth and casts cast the unclean into the eternal lake of fire to be punished forever. The faithful are taken to heaven to spend eternity praising the God who says, "Vengeance is mine." We have inherited a religious theology that verges on a blood cult. Spiritual terrorism is used to motivate people into submission. How can anybody honor and respect a God who plans to eternally torture non-believing neighbors? The real heroes in the Bible are those who, in the end times, witness God's brutal slaughter of the earth, but refuse to align themselves with such cruelty and reject his authority.
Fantastic.
I saw that letter too. I thought that was a great letter. I saw that one too.
Who wrote that?
This is from Paul Boudreau.
Do we know Paul?
No.
Okay.
Well done.
Are we getting Don's microphone now?
Yeah, test that other mic and see if he can hear you.
Can he be heard now?
Good. Go ahead,
testing,
Don.
Testing. Nope. No. Yes.
It's because it's sound cutting out.
Okay. I had it buried, I guess.
Down all the chest here.
All right, there. Sorry, folks. That one. That's what's so great about live TV.
All right. And all.
All right, Don. Did you want to go on to something else, or did you want to talk about Steven Weinberg?
Let me just hit on a couple of quick things that I'll forget if I don't say them now.
Not a problem.
I was privileged to be on a thing called the Dad Show on KAZI Radio, and the topic of this particular Dad Show was how does what role does religion play in raising kids? And every other person that was on there was a minister. I had five ministers there.
That's funny.
So it was pretty predominantly one way, but it was an interesting experience, and I found the group as a whole to be surprisingly tolerant. We disagreed about a few things. We probably could have sat there and disagreed about a whole lot of things, but the folks over there, they have a real good crew, and everybody was treated real nice, and I understand that will show on ACAC at some point in the future. Also, October 17th, I'll be speaking to the Unitarian Fellowship, which meets at Serrano's at Symphony Square. I believe that starts at 10:30 in the morning. And now I'd like to talk a little bit about the wonderful experience we had last weekend at First Cafeteria when we had Dr. Weinberg from UT, who is one of the preeminent people in the world in the physics arena. He's a genius and well recognized. Let me read you just a little bit of some of the stuff Susan Brown sent out about him. He was educated at Cornell, Copenhagen, Princeton, taught at Columbia, Berkeley, MIT, Harvard, where from 1973 to 1982 he was Higgins Professor of Physics. In 1982 he moved to the University of Texas and founded its theory group. At Texas he holds the Josie Rigenthal Chair of Science and is a member of the Physics and Astronomy departments. His research has spanned a broad range of topics in quantum field theory, elementary particle physics, and cosmology. And has been honored with numerous awards, including the Nobel Prize in Physics, the National Medal of Science, the Heinemann Prize in Mathematical Physics, the Crescent Medal of the Franklin Institute, the Madison Medal of Princeton University, and the Oppenheimer Prize. He also holds honorary doctoral degrees from a dozen universities. He is a member of the National Academy of Science, the Royal Society of London, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the International Astronomical Union, the American Philosophical Society. In addition to the well-known treatise Gravitation and Cosmology, he has written several books for general readers, including the prize-winning The First 3 Minutes, now translated into 22 foreign languages, The Discovery of Subatomic Particles, and most recently, Dreams of a Final Theory. Having a person of this kind of stature come speak to our group was really neat, and he said some, I thought, real thought-provoking things.
Yes.
He started off with a discussion of do religion and science conflict, and he quoted Stephen Jay Gould, and I'll have to kind of paraphrase a little bit, that religion concerns itself with how people should act, and science only deals with the facts. So there should be no conflict. And Dr. Weinberg said that he agreed with the final part of that, but not with the first, and emphatically stated that religion and science do in fact conflict, and conflict wherever religion makes claims of facts.
Yeah,
I thought that was real interesting. This was very good. He did a discussion of what has been the effect of religion, and he pointed out that throughout history, bad people have typically done bad things, and good people have done good things. But the predominant and consistent effect of religion has been to get good people to do bad things. He also talked about what should be taught in public school science classes, and he just made a whole lot of sense. He said sometimes scientific findings can contradict some particular religious tenet and upset somebody. Sometimes they will appear to support some other religious belief. Science classes must teach what is generally accepted by scientists, and regardless of the religious implications. And I think that's first rate. That cuts right to the core of that. He was asked why not teach creationism alongside evolution, and he stated that that would give creationism a standing that it as the alternative to evolution that it frankly does not deserve. And he gave the example of should flat earth material be taught alongside conventional geology, and of course the answer is no. Did y'all have a good time last Sunday?
Yes, and I want to apologize to all the people. That was the biggest turnout we've ever had for our speaker series, and from my understanding we had people that came late and was unable to get in, so we definitely want to apologize to those and invite you back next month. And I'm trying to think what the first Sunday, the exact date of the first Sunday in October is. But
third.
Is it?
I bet it's the third.
Okay. But the first Sunday in October, we'll be back at first.
Right.
And I'm embarrassed.
We have John Coons.
Thank you.
And he will also be on the show that day.
And John Coons is a member of our group. He's a science teacher here in Austin, and he does some great demonstrations and very entertaining when it comes to science. That's what's so good about it. He can explain really complicated ideas to the lay people and
make it
very understandable.
Good.
Yes,
and Steve Weinberg did. Guy.
Yeah, and Steve Weinberg was real good at that too. We had some very pointed questions from the audience, and he was able to get right to the meat of the subject.
That's right.
Very quickly, and so yes, I was quite thrilled to meet the gentleman in person there. You want anything you'd like to add to that, Jeff?
Oh, not particularly. There is a. There are like two sides of the does science and religion conflict issue, and I was happy to see that Professor Weinberg was on the same side as Richard Dawkins, who's another outspoken critic of the stance that Stephen Jay Gould takes. Because the fact is that only some Christians are willing to give up all of their religion's claims of fact and just go with the teachings about how people should behave. And most of them, when you really press them, they think that the claims of fact of their religion are the reason why you should behave the way their religion says you should behave. And so, you know, when those are in conflict with science, even those people have a problem. So to try to dodge it is I think Professor Weinberg said something to the effect of, you know, scientists are then dictating to religionists what their religion ought to mean to them.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He's telling that Stephen Jay Gould is in a sense telling religionists you have to give up all your religion's claims of factual of facts because that's science's territory, and of course they don't believe that. So there's a conflict.
Like I said, I like what he's saying there about having good people do bad things. My grandmother's no longer alive, but she went to church every Sunday. But she honestly thought black people were mud people and were actually less. She quit using the word nigger towards the end. But when I was a kid, she didn't think anything of it. You know, as the children of Ham, the mud people. I'm not that up on the tribes.
The children of Ham deal is from one of the early books. I think it's either Genesis or Exodus, and there's the children of Ham are supposed to be cursed.
And that's why we have slaves.
And wander the earth and be servants.
Right.
That is one of the passages that has been used to support slavery.
And like I said, she was, other than that, she was the most kind woman, you know, and she thought she was a good Christian and probably thinks she's in heaven. And she probably thought she was going to heaven, and, even though, and that was a perfect example of, you know, good people doing bad things without, right. Without having their conscience bother them whatsoever, because they've been brainwashed by that book, thinking that they would. Mm-hmm. So, like I said, just want to remind everyone, this is live, coming to you August 12th. I don't know if I have technical difficulties or not, but like, see if we can work everything out. I was trying to think. I see you brought in a book about the rapture, and we can go back to.
Let's go into that.
Okay. I know you haven't read the whole thing yet.
That's right.
So I don't want to put you on the spot. Well,
let me just let you know that something wonderful has happened in South Austin.
Okay.
And this is not a commercial, but it does have to do with a commercial enterprise. Borders Bookstore opened on South Lamar and Ben White, whatever. And my family and I went over there the other day just to check it out. We enjoy bookstores, and we've hit them all. And I was very pleased to find that they have the way they divide their subjects. They have a number of religious topics, and then they have a comparative religion section. And it was very interesting. I saw a lot of titles that I had already read. The George Smith book was there. And several that I'd never seen that were books that I would be interested in. And I grabbed one. And it is The Last Days Are Here Again.
It's a great title.
A History of the End Times. And the author in this goes back to the beginnings of early Christianity and does a kind of a survey of different beliefs and predictions about apocalypse or how the earth is supposed to end. I found it very interesting, and there's a lot more to it than I thought there was. For example, there's something called dispensational eschatology, and this has to
That's
do
a new one on me. Yeah.
This has to do with the existence of the earth being divided into ages, and each age has some kind of a special purpose where mankind is tested for something, and the general belief among dispensationalists is that the earth will last 6,000 years, and then the last 1,000 years will be the millennium. There's all kinds of millennium stuff in here. So a lot of the date setting that has gone on through history is to try to figure out when it's going to be 6,000 years from creation, and then the millennium is supposed to begin. And there are pre-millennials and post-millennials. And post-millennials have this kind of optimistic view of the world, that the world will get better and better and better until the end will be like 1,000 years of peace and justice, and then we'll all go away or whatever. And then there's the pre-millennials who think that the world is getting worse, and that we'll have and essentially what the pre means is that Jesus is going to come before the millennium, and we'll have the tribulation and everything, the Antichrist and all that, and then swing right into the millennium there. A lot of the predictions in America are better documented than throughout the Middle Ages. And in the last century, there was one group like the Millerites that set dates over and over and over again, and finally just lost all credibility with anybody that they had any idea what they were talking about. Jehovah's Witnesses and several other modern groups have been able to survive setting a date, and then Seventh-day Adventists also.
Good one.
Set dates, and then nothing happened, and they were able to learn from that and go on and survive. And part of what modern apocalyptics have learned is don't set dates. You know, when you make a falsifiable supernatural claim, then you're really asking for trouble because it'll be falsified.
Anyway, I've enjoyed what I've read of it. I have just a few pages left, and it's out there and it's available, and you can learn all about how the apocalypse has been predicted over and over again for almost 2,000 years now.
Now, another strategy, of course, is to predict a date that is so far in the future that you're not going to catch any flack for being wrong about it. Yeah. I understand that Pat Robertson has already pushed his prediction of the millennium off to the year 3000.
So he'll be dead in hundreds of years.
Yeah, he can keep racking in the dough during his lifetime, and he'll be fine.
All right, let's try the phones and see how they're working here. Let's see. Randall?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Randall. I recognize your voice.
Is this Don?
Yes, it is.
I certainly appreciate your calling me. I had to step out to get some stuff for breakfast. Listen, I really enjoy what you fellows are doing down there. I belong to the Freedom from Religion Foundation for years.
Fantastic.
I'm 73 years old, and I'm real anxious to get down there one of the days and meet you fellows. I can tell you some interesting stories that you may get a kick out of. My son lives in Austin. I have a son and daughter who lives in Austin, and he has sent me 4 or 5 of your tapes, which I really enjoyed.
Thank you.
And one of the tapes I had, they were talking about atheists in foxholes.
Uh-huh. And, yes, we get that a lot.
Pardon?
We get that point a lot.
Were you an atheist in a foxhole?
Yes, sir.
There we go, folks.
But one of my favorite stories, I don't know if you've heard it or not, that I tell them a lot, is about Mike and Joe were in a foxhole in Korea. I guess you could pick any war, and they were completely surrounded. There was just no way they could get out. So Joe says to Mike, "What can we do?" Mike says, "I don't know. There's just no way we can get out alive." So Joe says, "Well, I guess we can pray." And Mike says, "Well, that's a good idea," but he said, "I never went to church or anything." He said, "I don't know how to pray." And Joe says, "Well, I'm the same situation." He said, "I live next door to church too, but I never did learn how to pray." But he said, "I did hear them over there." He said, "I think I remember what they said." So Mike said, "Okay, go ahead." So they bowed their head. Mike told Joe, he says, "Go ahead." Joe goes under the B6.
He was next to a Catholic church, yes.
But good one. But you fellas doing, I did have the opportunity, it's been several years ago, I met, what's her name, from San Antonio?
Catherine?
Yeah.
Catherine Farringer, she's a great lady.
Yes,
she came up here with us last weekend to hear Dr. Weinberg.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. But I just wanted to give you a quick call and tell you how much I appreciate Don getting back to me. I copied the number off of one of the tapes, and my son's been trying to get over there, but they've just bought another house and in the process of moving and all that. But I just wanted to thank you guys a lot, and I'm really looking forward to getting down and meeting you.
Thank you, and
I'm looking forward to meeting
you. So I hope he's taping this program. I don't know whether he is or not.
Well, I'm flattered to hear that the tapes of our show are getting out there across the state there.
Randall, leave us a message if he didn't get it taped. I'm trying to tape it at home.
Oh, are you?
And so if he doesn't get it taped, we'll get one to you.
Well, I'd be glad to pay you for sending me the tape if you'll do it. I'll make a contribution.
Why, thank you. You have a great week.
Okay, thank you a lot.
Thank you.
Take
you.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye. All right, let's go on down to you. Stephanie?
Hello.
Good morning.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but doesn't the new millennium actually start 2001?
You're absolutely right.
Well, it really depends how you're figuring.
Right.
You know, I mean, technically, you count from 1 to 10, and the teens don't start till 11, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, so if you're going by that, 2001 is the millennium. And people ought to know that, but they don't. I mean, everybody looks at the three zeros and they go, "Woo!"
Yeah.
But then if you think that our calendar is supposed to be based on the birth of Christ, then you got all kinds of problems because, I mean, for one thing, we know that King Herod, who is supposed to have been a contemporary of Jesus's, died in what we call the year 4 BC.
Mm-hmm.
So by that reckoning, the millennium was 4 years ago. And I was just talking with some of the guys, and apparently there's reason to expect that maybe if there was an historical Jesus, the calendar is off by as much as 7 years. So,
Oh, well, I'm an atheist, and I just thought, well, if the world does end, it's not going to be for another year, so.
yeah, we're counting centuries, and so the 21st century will not start until, and it's 2001. I'm trying to break everybody in the habit of the 2000, because it was 1900, and it'll be 2100. Just because we have three zeros doesn't mean we have to change it and call it 2000.
Right.
It'll be 2100.
But I don't know. There's just something about the fact that it changes from one set of numbers and then the three zeros. Plus, you've got the Y2K thing, the crisis that everybody's looking for on January 1st. So, you know, I think this New Year's will be a bigger deal than 2001.
Of course, most people can do it twice.
That's going to happen this year is because of all the idiots.
Yeah, but you know, idiots throw good parties too. And that's my brother's plan for the next 2 years. I mean, I was talking with him about it, and he said, you know, everybody's gonna go nuts in the year 2000, and there'll be lots of big parties. And he plans on going to all of them, and then. And people do it again in 2001. He'll go again. So, you know, it's not going to hurt anything.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
I appreciate your input.
No problem.
Yep. All right. So, remind everyone, this is live August 12th. We'll take phone calls, any questions you want to have on there. And just remind everyone, once we're done here, we head right down to the bagel shop down at West 5th and Lavaca.
Come on down, Stephanie.
If anybody did get wafted away to heaven yesterday, we'd appreciate a call from you, too.
Well, you know, we haven't had any Christian callers, so maybe they're gone.
They might be gone.
Yeah, that could be gone. Yeah,
prove us wrong, Christians. Call in.
We don't have our usual.
Show us that, in fact, the rapture didn't happen.
If the rapture did happen, then any Christians that call won't be real Christians, right?
Good point. Yes.
It's too confusing.
Stop it. We'll lose callers.
The phones are lighting up.
Yeah, we see
they're still around.
Well, before we take any of them, let me just throw this out here. We talk about things that atheists might enjoy. Here's something you might get a kick out of. It is says right here at the top, world's pretty much only religious satire magazine. And on here they've got on the cover is this is Attack of the Evangelical Horror Movies. It's got funny stuff, interviews and jokes, Christian fortune cookies, all kinds of things. This is not an atheist publication, by the way. This is put out by a group in Dallas that is Christian, but they poke fun at everybody. And it's called The Door. It's not hard to find if you're a fan of religious humor.
It's a great. You brought in a couple copies. You're the one that turned me on to that magazine. Yes, and I was real impressed with it. Yes.
And for those that subscribe, they have that tape of those of y'all that watch the Daily Show. Right. Daily Show. I don't know. They still do the God stuff
occasionally. Yeah.
Yes, they do.
And when I subscribed, they sent me that tape, and we've all enjoyed that. That's been a lot of fun.
All right. Let's try the phones again here. Let's see. Ron?
Hello, how are you?
Hi, Ron.
Just want to let you know, first off, I am a Christian. But I also want to know that, or want to let you know that I do believe in what you're doing, because I believe that different walks of life around the country, I believe everybody has the right to their own belief, and that I don't think what you're doing is wrong.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Everybody has their own beliefs, and I think that's what our country was founded on, is the differences. And if we didn't have differences, we would all be perfect, and that would be terrible, right?
No. I'm afraid I don't agree with you on that point. I think we should all be as good as we could possibly be, and you know, I don't think that some kind of preference for differences ought to be used as an excuse to be wrong.
Right.
But we certainly agree that everybody has the right to believe whatever it is they believe.
So y'all carry on and enjoy your day, and keep believing what you want to believe, because I think that's okay.
I'd like to touch on something that Ron said. Ron, you said that our country was founded on the idea of
of differences being okay. I forget exactly the words you used. And I don't want to tell you you're wrong or anything, but my point of view is that one reason that we have the government that we have and some of the rights that we have is when they came together in the Constitutional Convention and in other places, there was diversity. They weren't all Baptists. They weren't all Catholics. They weren't. There was a variety there. And so at that time, as they were putting the government together, they were people that respected each other, and they incorporated that into the documents that our government's founded on. And yeah, we're very lucky.
Exactly right. I'm currently going through a government class, a U.S. government class, and I got to really thinking really hard about some things, and that's true. They were all different walks of life, and we were all trying to get along, and we didn't want to have to live in a country where we were dictated about what to do. So that was the reason for writing our rights, or making our rights in our government, so that they can understand everybody's beliefs.
Right, right. Well, the government is going to tell you what to do, but we draw the line. They can't tell you what to think.
That's right. Exactly right. Well, y'all have a good day.
You too, Ron.
All right, bye.
Take care. All right. Whoops. Hit the wrong button. Okay. Let's go on down to Ed.
Wow, that was fast. I wanted to ask if any of you heard anything about the Southern Baptists where they pissed off a bunch of Jewish people because they were doing
We did a news story about that. The Southern Baptist, what does it say? The Southern Baptist Mission Board, International Mission Board, released a prayer guide which told Southern Baptists to pray for Jews to convert to Christianity.
Right. Oh, okay. I must have missed that. I woke up late. Sorry.
That's all right. It's okay.
Presumably Southern Baptist Christianity. I don't think those Southern Baptists would be real happy if all those Jews became, say, Catholics.
Right.
What? Let's hear your point of view on that.
Well, I just thought it was pretty intolerant, you know.
Yeah.
And it sort of was linked to what you were saying about how there's all this diversity and stuff, and that's how our government was formed. And then here you have one group of, you know, religious people sort of attacking another group. I'm not sure. I didn't read the article or anything, so I'm not sure exactly what transpired. But
I'm not
sure. Sounds kind of radical.
I'm not sure how I would feel about that if, you know, if I found out that there was a prayer guide out there telling a bunch of Christians to wish in unison that atheists became Christians. You know, I think I'd just laugh.
Yeah.
Because I don't see any power in prayer. But if you're another religious organization who may believe in the existence of some supernatural power or other, I can see where that might seem a little threatening.
Right. Yeah. It just seemed really intolerant, and I thought, you know, I'd ask if you guys had heard anything about it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it could be worse. I mean, at least, you know, if they go off and pray, then if they're praying for me to be a Christian, then I don't have to deal with that. They're doing that over there. When they knock on my door and want to witness to me, then that's something else. When they my daughter feels pressured at school to participate in some religious activity, you know, then you're treading on ground that's gonna cause some negative waves.
Right.
You got to keep in mind one of the tenets of Christianity is conversion.
Right. Is to recruit.
Right.
Yeah. I was just curious. I didn't know what lengths they had gone to try to convert these Jews to Christianity, or what they intended to do or anything. But
you mean recently, right? Because we know what lengths they've gone to historically.
Right, yeah. But I meant currently what's happening. Like I said, I didn't read the article, but it sort of caught my attention there. I thought, oh, here we go again. Another one of those.
You know, it's probably time for us to get that atheist missionary corps together. Get out and start knocking on doors and...
Hey, imagine, you know, knock, knock, knock. Hello. Hi, have you heard the good news about Jesus? No, what's that? It was all just a story. You're fine. Your soul's not in any danger. Thanks. Thanks for your time.
By the way, I'm not sure who got my email, but I found a bumper sticker that says, honk if you're Jesus.
If you're Jesus.
If you are Jesus.
Yes.
I thought that was pretty funny.
Yes, it was.
Anyway, you guys are doing a great job.
Thank you. You have a great week.
Thanks for calling. Yeah, you might want to invite that guy down to the bagel shop.
Yeah,
sure. Yeah, come on down. Ed sounds like an interesting guy.
Or anyone else that would like to come down to the bagel shop, it's free and open to the public. And we always like meeting the new people down there. And it looks like you're looking up something. Bumper stickers?
In my door magazine, he mentioned bumper stickers. So in here there's companion bumper stickers we'd like to see. The bumper sticker is, my boss is a Jewish carpenter, and the companion is, and I'm his fat-ass lazy employee. And here's one, the no Jesus, no peace, no Jesus, no peace one. And the companion is, no Jesus, no money, be a televangelist. And angels are watching over me, except when I play with myself.
I like this one, real men love Jesus.
And hookers, just ask Eugene Robinson.
Those are some great ones, yes.
It's funny.
I was trying to think, there was other news going on this week, and I had it on my mind there right before we started the bumper stickers there, and I forgot it already.
I was correct, yeah.
I jarred it.
Yes, that's quite all right. We were talking about it beforehand, all the presidential candidates are backing vouchers in one form or another.
Not vouchers. They may be, but as I understand it, every single major presidential candidate, Republican and Democrat, has come out in favor of the idea of enlisting faith-based organizations to administer government social programs. Okay? That means, like, hiring churches to, like, you know, hand you your benefit check or something. I don't know exactly what this would entail, except that it would give all those organizations yet another opportunity to seem important and vital in everybody's life, and that's just dangerous.
I'd also seen where quite a few of the candidates are backing some form of school vouchers.
They may well be. Almost certainly all the Republicans are.
Yeah, they all have fine-tuned it one way or another, but basically they're all in there on that one. I see we have Joe online. Let's see if it... Joe?
Hi, guys. How are you today?
Hi, Joe. Good.
I kind of agree with Ron. You know, it's good to have both sides, and it's, for years, there's been like an ongoing war, it seems, that organizations like yours, which are good, they seem to be picking out psychics or fakers of religion, and it seems like then they're being used to imply that all religious believers are quacks, in a sense of the word. And I would like to imply religion kind of as an example. When you have a sickness like a flu virus or something within you,
all right,
your friends around you might say, well, he's crazy, I can't see this virus, but within you, you kind of feel it yourself, and that's kind of what the basis of religion is. It's kind of with the faith. It's
no,
except that with a virus, you can take a microscope and look at it.
There is evidence. I mean, it is a real thing.
Yeah,
there's way more to it than just a feeling.
Yeah. You can take the temperature, and there's all kinds of mine. Our floor manager was talking about a mind virus, and he passed a little joke. Said, sorry about that. But yeah, there's several ways. You know, like I say, the microscope, the symptoms that your body's going through, you know.
The fact that you give somebody an antidote and they get better.
Exactly.
Right.
And religion has no comparative, there's nothing that would compare to that when it comes to religion is what I'm trying to say. Unless you can point something out that does.
Well, mentally, let's say perhaps religion were a placebo.
Uh-huh.
And by believing in it strongly, it gave you the strength to heal. As where without that placebo, you have nothing to believe in.
I think you misunderstand what placebos really are. Okay, you can't like cure somebody of a serious illness with a placebo. The best you can do is you can ease their worry about it, but they still got the disease.
What would drive you to go on in a situation of death where you want to fight? Where would you get your strength from if you don't have something to believe in?
My own personal experience is I enjoy life so much that I'm going to fight it till the very end. I'm going to try to do the best because I know there's nothing else after this, so I want to make the best use of the time while I'm here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I take care of my health through diet and exercise and try to extend my life as far as I can, as long as I can.
Plus, being the descendant of, you know, untold generations of ancestors who only survived long enough to reproduce so that I could exist because they felt a desire to go on existing themselves. I've inherited that survival instinct, so I don't really have to worry about it.
I guess that's where it is. You know, it's like, it's political in a sense of the word, that each belief comes from two areas, and I guess you just have to choose that sometimes. And it's not really that it's bad that one would have a choice to believe in faith or God to get better and get up and walk again, whether, or you yourself, like you say, enjoy life so much, that would be your reason. It's not really bad, you know. And then another thing I did want to touch on, I'm looking at our new age, and we talk about the millennial changes and prophecies and all those things, and
right.
There are a lot of quacks out there, but it speaks about new things here in the Bible. It talks about wars and rumors of wars, but that's been going on. But here's what it's saying. It's saying there's going to be islands and mountains running away to the seas, just totally leveled. Before, we've never had this, but now we have the science and the technology to actually do these things. And the chip implant is here. They're using it in the government.
Oh,
and
grief.
We have our new world order, for example.
Yeah, the Bible does not say chips.
Yes, it does. The mark of the beast.
The Bible says the mark of the beast, which meant to the people in those days a tattoo. Right? It didn't mean a chip. If they had meant some kind of, you know, high-tech implant, they'd have said something that indicated that, and they didn't.
It says no man can buy or sell anything without.
Yeah. And they could have, and in those days, people could be marked, and you couldn't buy or sell something unless you could display that mark.
And that was,
and it didn't require any high technology for tattoos to suit that purpose in those days.
And part two of that is, in the cashless society today, without credit cards, and I mean charge accounts,
you're
seeing it move that way. And with the actual chip and technology embedded now, that they're using it, even in dogs, you can scan your dog with this chip.
Yeah.
And to me,
yeah,
that's an appealing thing.
See,
don't you see technology moving toward that system, though?
Yeah, can I go back just a second to something you said earlier?
Yeah.
You said you didn't see any harm in people believing in God and Jesus as long as it. I forget exactly what your justification was, you know, but
if it made them better,
help them get through their sickness. The problem with belief in the supernatural is not the belief itself, but the risk that if, for example, somebody believes because of their religion that the disease they've got is a supernatural force that can't be treated medically, but can only be treated, you know, magically, supernaturally, through prayer or whatever.
Those events,
and they're wrong,
so, you know.
Right? Hang on. If somebody believes that because of their religion and they're wrong, that's the bad part.
Right.
Okay? If they allow their religion to blind them to the facts, and when you come at us with, well, it says Mark of the Beast in the Bible, therefore chip implants are proof that the Bible is accurate or that the world is going in the direction that the Bible said, I think you're doing that. I think you're crossing that line. Because you're taking two completely different things and saying that they're the same because your religion says so.
And then I had a couple more. And calling out the Mark of the Beast, if from what I understand, once that's in there, you can't even see it. So if you can't see it, how would it be a mark? Okay, and then the other point is, there is a service now on the internet where you can actually buy stuff completely anonymous. So the technology that you say is causing that is also giving us a way around that. And from what I understand, it's perfectly legal. The guy's not here. It's not set up here in the United States. What you do, so they're real worried about drug money being laundered through this, but there's nothing the United States can do about it. You can actually go on the internet and spend thousands of dollars and be completely anonymous and not have to give any personal information whatsoever. So
right. I understand that. And okay. I'm just trying to point out, you know, with the New World Order and the one world leader it talks about, I can just personally, I see it all coming, you know, and I'm just trying to put it together that way.
What you can see
have a nice day. I'm going to go. I just want to bring
thanks
you
for
good
calling.
Point.
Thanks. All right. What it is you're seeing is things that have vague connotations, vague connections, you know, they remind you of stuff said in the Bible. And it's not evidence that the Bible is true. It's evidence that you as a human being are able to draw connections between unrelated things on the slimmest of evidence.
I'd like to address a couple of things he talked about.
He was. He started by saying that we address the fakers, and we draw conclusions from that and to everything else. And until somebody can make a claim and we can see it happen, like make a prediction about the future, and it happens. I think that's fair. I think it's fair to generalize a little bit about that. And the idea that these beliefs cause no harm, they're just kind of feel-good things, I don't think that's true. There's people that are schizophrenic and don't take their medicine because of religious beliefs. There's people that don't treat their children's illnesses because of religious beliefs.
There's people that make it no longer necessary to teach evolution
there you go.
In an entire state in the public schools because of their religious beliefs.
It just steers you wrong.
Yeah. We should have asked that guy about the rapture. I'm sure he had an opinion.
All right. Let's go on down to Mary.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mary.
I watched The Road to Rapture on 36. And
yeah.
Did anybody else see that?
I saw it.
No.
Yeah, it started out well. It started out it was this thing on TV talking about the history of like failed rapture predictions.
Right.
That was fine, but the wrap up was like, you know, nobody knows when the rapture will really occur, but it brings a message of hope.
Oh, well, I blew off that part.
I did too, but I didn't fail to notice it.
I got what I wanted out of it and threw the rest of it away. What I got out of it was that it's no big deal. They've been doing this for so long that we don't have to waste any energy on this. Okay, that guy was talking about the mark of the beast, right?
Yeah.
Well, that comes from social control, okay? And we're moving away from that intellectually because the people that we have as leaders are revealing that they don't know any more than we do, and why should they be the boss, okay? Like, they're not the boss of me in any way, mm-hmm. but I want to go on to something even more interesting, and that's viral evolution, okay? Well, that's interesting to me, but have you heard of the antibiotic-resistant virus strains that
sure.
are showing up?
Yeah.
Well, see, the bond I have with nature, it's so awesome, and it's so loving, and so... It means everything to me, okay? It means more to me than my relations with humans, because she doesn't lie to me, ever. And she reveals herself in facts, and that's a fact. But she does those things to show that it's real. Evolution is a real thing. It goes on all the time, and that's why the religionists are having to deal with that micro versus macro evolution. Okay, well, it's real on the micro level because we've got these viruses that I guess they evolved and they're resistant to antibiotics, so we have to explain them some kind of way. So let's accept evolution on the micro level, but we don't have to accept it on the macro level.
Yes.
Well, I mean, one is part of the other, and I know you don't like the word holistic, but holistic, it is a whole thing in a lot of ways. We are in one cosmos as far as we're concerned. Maybe there is something out there, but we haven't gotten there yet. Right now, we've got to deal with what we've got here and what we're doing to it.
Well, Mary, I don't have any problem with the word holistic,
mm-hmm.
but I do have issue with the some of the claims that are being made under that word. If you go to, I was in a pharmacy yesterday, and they had racks and racks of bottles of pills that cost $40, and due to truth in labeling, they're saying may improve memory and, you know, stuff like that. And that's disturbing to me, because there's a whole culture building up around
this. Talk about that.
Think about it this way. In the political realm, look what they did to a perfectly good term called liberal, okay?
Right.
I've been a political liberal for the longest time because the heart is on the left side, okay? I'm a leftist because my heart is on the left side. And now they've demonized the word to where it's almost an epithet, you know? And I'm very careful about what they do with words because language is how we communicate.
Yeah. Well, while we're talking about what we're doing with words,
uh-huh.
I'm kind of taken aback by your use of the feminine pronoun she and her for nature. Why are you personifying
because
nature?
Because she gives birth, Jeff.
Huh?
Because she gives birth.
Nature.
What, all of nature all at once?
Well, no. In different, like the ovum gives off just a few eggs at a time. You know,
yeah,
it isn't a whole thing.
But nature isn't a person.
Well, yeah, I guess. I guess I genderize it because of, I'm a sentimental fool.
Sentimentally, it's perfectly okay. But there are people that really think that, you know, all they do is they believe in a thing that is God, but they think that the God is nature and not you know, the Christian God.
Okay.
And there's no difference there as far as I can see.
I can explain it to you on an emotional level, okay?
Oh, there's no need to explain it to me on an emotional level. If that's all it is, I understand that.
For me, that's what it is, because I grew up as a throwaway kid, an orphan, and I didn't have a mother. And she replaced my mother, and that's why.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah. All right.
It's kind of harmless, really.
Yeah.
Okay. As long as we all know what we're talking about.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye.
You have a great
holiday, Mary.
Yes.
Can I break in here just a second?
Sure.
Well, Don brought up the thing about
the medicine.
The medicine.
Yes.
I don't know if any of you have caught these ads for what's it called? Onhealth.net. It's a website. I'm not sure I've got the name right, but they've done a series of ads poking fun at some of these new age medical beliefs. Like, there's this sweaty guy who gets up in the middle of the night and goes to his refrigerator, and he takes like these refrigerator magnets and holds them up to his head,
right,
and it cuts to a screen that says, "What's the deal with magnets?" And it has another one where there's this family moving furniture around in their grandmother's room, and she's lying in bed, and they get the dresser over to one corner, and bing, she like sits up. And they go, "Grandma," they set the dresser down, and the instant that they move it out of the position they were holding it in, boom, she falls back down again. Right? And that was making fun of feng shui. And there's another one making fun of humor in medicine, where this guy is showing how to tell jokes to one of those medical dummies. Right? He's like, you know, making fart noises at it and stuff. I really liked those ads. Then I went to the website.
Uh-oh.
And it's all full. It's chock full of New Age hokum. Mm. They bend over backwards to excuse the lack of evidence in support of this stuff. Apparently, those ads are just a gimmick to make them seem like they're level-headed because they make fun of this. Now it's self-deprecating, and they go ahead and sell you that stuff anyway.
Sad. So, yeah, anyone that's making medical claims with just anecdotal evidence only should not be taken, because the science and medical community will not take that as evidence for any medical claims whatsoever.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people out there medical claims just on anecdotal evidence only.
Yeah.
All right, let's go on down to Sue.
Yeah, hi, I'm enjoying your show. I just had a question for you guys.
Sure.
Are either of you married?
I'm married.
Divorced.
Now, how did you guys get married? Obviously, you didn't do it in front of God and church.
No. I was married in a hotel in Houston. We had a banquet room there, and the man that married us was a minister, but he was a Unitarian minister, which doesn't really count. So we had a secular service, and it was very nice.
My wife and I were married in front of a justice of the peace, with just like us and a few of our close friends and the guy in this courtroom, and we were married across this table that had little toy cars on it and like strips of tape down marking out roads, because they used this courtroom to do like traffic accident stuff. That was really amusing. But then we repeated the ceremony several months later in a Methodist church to please our families, who are both very religious. And I had a good old time. I didn't have to deal with the religiosity of it at all. I just tolerated it. But the big impression that I got out of that is, to get married in that church, it is required that you go in for these counseling sessions with the minister beforehand. And the minister is like sitting us down and gravely telling us, you know, here is the importance of the relationship that you're entering into and the responsibilities that you have to each other and stuff. And we like picked it up from there and started telling him exactly what we understood this relationship to be that we were forming with each other. And he sat there stunned, and then he said, "Wow, I have never met people as prepared for a life of marriage as you two." And And it struck me, here's a guy whose job it is to, theoretically, to prepare his flock in his church to be responsible people, to understand, you know, commitments and things, right, and be able to live a good life. And he's telling me that, you know, me, an atheist, is like the most prepared person for marriage he's ever met. He's not doing his job. It shocked me. Yeah, anyway, Sue, does that answer your question, ma'am?
Yes, it sure does. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Sue. Bye. Thanks for the call.
You have a great week. Let's go on down to Larry.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Larry.
Good morning, Larry.
I'm Larry, and I haven't been to church in 27 years.
Yeah. All right. We noticed you didn't get raptured yesterday, neither.
Oh, no, and I'd like to put in a vote for the day. Is there going to be any prizes?
Well, yeah, all the stuff left behind by the people that get raptured, you can have it.
I'm picking October 9th of the year 2004.
Okay.
October 9th. John Lennon's birthday, I expect.
We will jot you down.
Whose birthday is that?
John Lennon.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, I'd like to tell y'all a story.
Sure. Okay.
Sure.
My best friend in the world died of a heart attack 3 weeks ago.
I'm sorry.
And then I watched some incredible paramedics come in and revive her. And then some incredible doctors at St. David's Hospital and Seton Hospital have brought her back.
Mm-hmm. That is
fantastic.
And if one more person tells me that those doctors didn't do it, that God did it, I may get violent. Let's give credit where credit is due.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
So how's she doing now?
She's up. She's walking around. She's still got tubes and stuff sticking out of her, but she's going to make it.
That's good news.
And, I don't even think God ever came for a visit. Also, I would like to say that Steven Weinberg was just incredible.
Wasn't he, though?
And I was as impressed with the intelligence of the questions as I was with the intelligence of the answers.
There you go. And, so we'll see you down at the bagel shop.
You betcha.
All right.
Yeah, great. Easy, Larry.
All right, bye. Call.
Thank you. Well, just remind everyone, this is September 12th. I don't know why I got August stuck in my mind there. It's September 12th, and we will be taking your phone calls live on the air. I did remember one thing that happened this week. We got into a discussion about faith, and the person, and it comes up on the phone calls all the time, we have faith that the sun's coming up tomorrow or whatever. And it occurred to me while I was talking to him that it's not, I don't have faith, I have trust. And they brought up the example about driving the car, that we're going down the highway at 60 miles an hour.
Right.
We have faith that that person's going to stay in that lane. No, I have trust that...
Well, yes. Yeah, trust is a good word for it, but I mean, in a sense, it's faith as well. But religious faith is something different.
Yes.
The faith or trust, however you want to say it, about the cars staying on their side of the road is based on something.
Yeah.
Right. Good point.
At the very least, we're talking about a matter of degree. I mean, if they insist that everything from the expectation that the sun will come up tomorrow, with all of the evidence behind that, and faith that this big cosmic being in the sky that you've never seen and can't prove exists really does exist, if they're going to say both of those are covered by the word faith, then you got to look at the issue of, well, how much, you know?
Right.
And then if it takes very, very little here, well, sometimes very little of something is good and a whole lot of something is bad, you know? It's not all good just because it has the same name.
Then I guess I've been saying the wrong date. Now that I said the right date, the phone calls are
Everybody thought it was a rerun.
Yeah, everybody must have thought
don't
it was
a rerun. Don't we have the date up on the screen?
No, we don't. Let's go on down to Joe.
Hey, how are y'all doing?
Doing good, Joe.
Good show.
Thank you.
And I'm not an atheist. I do believe in Jesus Christ and all that stuff.
But you could be an atheist. We could send a missionary over to you, and we can help. We can. I mean, you just have to kind of let go.
Yeah, let go. Let me. No, no. I'm just. Y'all have a right. You know, it used to bother me in my earlier years that people had. You know, but everybody on this planet has a right to be.
We do.
And
we do.
And be who you are.
Right.
I choose to call that God gives us individualized expression, and I don't think I'd be expanding in human consciousness if it wasn't for God. What about y'all? What do you think is leading your your way? Is it faith? Or I just want to know a little bit about y'all's beliefs.
What's our way?
It's not faith.
Yeah. So faith in what atheists mean? Can you tell me that?
An atheist. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Don. You were ready.
Well, I will repeat what you've said over and over again, that a real classic, widely acceptable definition is that we are, as atheists, without a belief in a God. And for many of us, that in the group at least, we find that quickly translates into a challenge of anything supernatural. But what the word means is without theism, without an active belief in God. It doesn't mean that you believe there's no God.
Yeah. So you believe there
maybe
is.
Maybe splitting hairs a little bit, but it's one of those distinctions we like to make.
So you believe in a power greater than yourself, right?
No.
You don't?
Well, a locomotive is more powerful.
Learning from a book, for instance, isn't that power greater than yourself?
Well, somebody took the trouble to write it, and published it, and probably cost a tree some material, and those are all real things, part of nature, and somebody going out and doing work.
When I read books, even when I read books by big name physicists and biologists, I'm not picking up the book and saying to myself, "Well, this guy's a power greater than myself, therefore every word in this book is absolutely true."
Well, that's
I think about what I'm reading, and a lot of times I don't agree with the words that I'm reading. I take what seems to make sense out of it, and I leave the rest.
Okay.
So I don't know if you can call that believing in a power greater than myself. It's certainly acknowledging that there are some people out there that know stuff that I don't.
What about higher self or lower self? Isn't there a part of you that's trying to challenge you in the day that might be, trying to make your day a little more destructive than, like I could listen to this other voice sometimes in my head that says I need to make more money or blah, blah, blah. Fear comes in.
Yeah. I think we recognize that we have multiple things going on in our brains, and some of them are more rational than others, and we struggle with that like anybody else.
Okay, so
can I ask you a question real quick, Joe?
Yes, sir.
Let's say that a spaceship landed tomorrow in Washington, and these aliens introduced themselves. I mean, it really happened. It's not just somebody's figment. And these people are bigger, faster, smarter, and can do lots of things that we can't do. Would it be appropriate to worship them?
No, I wouldn't worship them.
Really?
No.
Okay. That's
but
good.
But they would be a certainly a different challenge for my mind to comprehend and to assimilate. It would be I'm kind of open to all kinds of stuff. They're finding new dinosaurs and everything else in the world. And so there's not
new
really
dinosaurs.
One answer that I can rest back on and say, this is it. This is it as I see it. I see this world as being diverse with a bunch of differences between peoples, and sometimes I think religion creates those that warlike environment where
amen.
I practice spirituality, and I put Jesus Christ first in my life. I just wonder what y'all think of Jesus.
I personally don't think the person ever existed. I think it's all myth.
Really?
But there are people in our group that call themselves atheists that think that there was a person there, but they don't think he was a supernatural person. But they feel that it was a person that done some good deeds that got embellished over the years.
Well, sure. That rational thought that you did mention, is rationalism part of y'all's belief too?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yes, okay. we think that's one thing that makes humans really neat as a species, is that we are capable of it.
So y'all believe in
the
intellect and the emotions combined, or the intellect overriding the emotion?
Well, it depends. As far as living our lives as people, emotion is part of what makes us human beings and colors our lives. As far as what telling what is real and what the truth is, then the intellect is superior to emotion.
Yeah, there's a lot of people that are emotionally ungrown up, and you know that as well as I do. And
sure.
But I do believe that intellect and emotions have to be married together in such a way to where I wouldn't be able to send out love if I didn't have it. What do you think of the word love?
I think it's a very valid emotion, and I love the human race in general, and then I got specific people in my life that I love more than others, of course.
I have a puppy dog and a 9-year-old daughter and a wife that I cherish them all.
That's beautiful.
lots of friends that I care a lot about.
That's beautiful. There's a lot of people that, including myself in the past, that used to have beliefs that, oh, well, you know, this just doesn't jive with my brain. But no, everybody's got a right to be here, and I appreciate y'all's show and just standing up for what you believe in.
Thanks for the call, Joe.
Okay. Thank you for calling.
Have a good day.
All right, we're down to 15 minutes here. Let's try to get as many as we can. David?
Yes, good morning. Enjoying the show. I heard all the good comments about the lecture last week.
Yes.
Was not able to attend, but I'm hoping that it was recorded and that the tape would be available. Is that correct?
I don't know. I really don't know if it would be available. I do know that there's people made audio tapes, but whether or not Steven Weinberg...
We'd have to have his permission to give it to somebody else. But, you know, I mean, we can ask. It was very good, but I think it was a lot better being there, frankly.
I understand, but I just couldn't be.
Well, sorry about that, yes.
I understand.
Well, I'll check with you by email.
All right.
Okay.
Thank
great.
You much.
Thank
it,
you.
It with that much response, we'll definitely have to see if we can get him back again sometime
right.
in the future. It, maybe in 6 months or so.
Yeah, I think I know who that was. That's a member of ours. That's an elderly fellow and very supportive of our organization. And this is an important outreach for him. And,
yes. Well, but I think we have to get Steven Weinberg's permission.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We can't make any promises without discussing them with him. All right. Let's go on down to Brian.
Yes. I, for one, would just like to state that I don't trust that the person next to me in traffic is going to stay in his lane. I hope he's going to stay in his lane.
Hope. Okay, good point.
Well, I don't know if that would be strong enough to allow me to go out and drive a car.
Well, if you don't drive with four wheels, you don't have a roll cage, and you aren't given the option of not being aware. I practice the theory of reasonable expectations that if I am aware... really aware of what's happening around me, I should hope that I should see somebody do something in time enough to react to it and not get caught by it.
That's good good survival practice.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's the same theory of reasonable expectations that would state that if you go up to somebody and say hello to them, they don't pull a gun and shoot you.
Right. Very
good point.
Theory of reasonable expectations.
Right.
Good show today, guys.
Talk Thank to you, you very much. Appreciate the call.
That was great input, yes. All right, let's go on down to Howard.
Hi. I got a little problem, I guess, with Webster, the guy that wrote the dictionary. And
Webster.
I guess it's the guy that wrote the dictionary, or one of the dictionaries I have.
Right.
I got a 1988 version, so I might have an old one. But I've heard from people that...
Can you speak up just a little bit, Howard?
What's that?
Can you speak up just a little bit? I'm having trouble hearing.
Yeah, I think I have a bad connection.
Thank you.
But I'll try.
Okay.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. My dictionary says atheist, a person who believes that there is no God. And I've heard that other people have seen that in the dictionary as well.
Right.
And so that would be one reason why I don't call myself an atheist. Although, according to your guys' definition, I guess I am.
Yeah.
But,
well...
I'm a little bothered by that.
Yeah. Jeff has explained this really well, so I'll give you a break. there's essentially what's been called a strong and a weak atheist. That definition, a person that believes that there is no God, would be an acceptable definition of a strong atheist. Is that pretty much how you see it? And most, or a great many atheists, are not comfortable with that. They classify themselves as weak atheists or not having the belief, lacking the belief rather than a belief in the lack of a God.
Yes, now I've heard a similar thing using the word explicit and implicit.
But yes, there's different,
right.
There's like a positive
and a negative. But the only thing is, if people look up the word in the dictionary and see the definition atheist, a person who believes that there is no God, and I tell them that I'm an atheist, they're going to get the wrong idea.
Well, it depends what dictionary you look in. My understanding is that the Oxford Dictionary has either the definition of atheism that we use or the one we use is one of several listed in that dictionary. So you can always refer to a source that that describes atheism the way that it's easier to defend. You know, I'm personally a strong atheist, but when I argue, I generally argue the weak atheist position because that is easier to defend and already sufficient to justify atheism.
Yeah, because it's a known fact in logic that you can't prove a negative. So I prefer the definition, no beliefs on or about the supernatural, and leave it up to them to define what their meaning of God is.
Okay, actually, I'm going to look up that Oxford item. Thanks
okay.
for mentioning that.
All right.
Yeah, I guess that's all I have.
All right, yeah, great. We have
come on down to the bagel shop.
All right, thanks.
We'll talk about it.
All right. We have a bunch of callers. Let's try to get as many as we can. We just lost Lee. I didn't disconnect her. She didn't. She okay. Ephraim? Ephraim?
Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Lost them too.
We lost
okay.
them.
Something's happening in the control.
Well, we got a break here.
Like. Yeah.
Let me this is the
call back, folks.
Newsletter for the Freedom From Religion Foundation. One of our callers earlier mentioned that they were a member of this. The FFRF is having a convention the
yes.
first weekend in November. It'll be at the St. Anthony Hotel in San Antonio, a very nice four-star hotel. This is a neat organization. If you ask them, they'll say that they're not strictly an atheist organization, although you'd never know it by being around them or reading their newsletter. They're led by atheists. They're atheist-friendly. There's an article in here by Catherine Farringer about using the word atheist. So this will be a real interesting convention. I've been to one of their conventions before. If you're an atheist or freethinker, you'll love it.
All right. And I see a bunch of lights here. I'm waiting to get the names here. But if we lost you folks, we'd love for you to call back. Let's try again here. Sue?
Hi. It's me. I just called back again for a follow-up. Can you explain on Unitary Church and where are you meeting later today at the bagel shop?
Yes,
right.
That's it. That's West 5th and Lavaca. The one ways make it kind of confusing, so it watch out for all the one ways down there. And I'll let Don say
Well, I mentioned earlier that I'll be speaking at the Unitarian Fellowship, which meets at Serrano's Symphony Square, and I'll be there on October 17th at 10:30.
But you were married by a Unitary Church?
Oh, yes. I was married by a Unitarian minister. Right.
So what does that mean? What kind of religion is that?
Well, Unitarians are... originally Unitarian was opposed to the Trinitarian doctrine. In other words, they chose one God instead of three. Nowadays, it's kind of vague, and you really don't have to have any kind of supernatural beliefs to be a Unitarian.
They claim to be atheist friendly too. That they'll welcome atheists.
You know, I've seen things in the paper of something I wanted to see, and it was at a Unitarian church, and I've gone and visited and seen other people from our group there and met other atheists there. So they are atheist friendly. They kind of remind me of humanists. It has a church feel, but what they're talking about is here and now.
Do you guys have a website?
Yes.
Yes, we do. www.atheist-community.org. It's right there on the TV screen.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot, guys.
You have a great week.
We also have a voicemail number if you need any information. It's 371-2911. Leave us a message, and we'll get back to you.
Great job, Vic. You're right on top of it. The Reader?
Mr. Reader.
Mr. Reader. Mr. Reader?
Oh, no, I got an OED here, so I was going to read the definition of atheist for you.
Oh, okay.
The first one is one who denies or disbelieves the existence of a God, which would be the strong definition. The second one is one who practically denies the existence of a God by disregard of moral obligation to him or a godless man.
Yeah, this, the first definition, it says denies or disbelieves.
Right, but the first one's a strong definition.
The first one is both definitions. Denies would be the strong atheist. Disbelieves would be the weak atheist.
We have to go back and look up believe.
Okay.
And what book?
Definition OED. Bye-bye.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for
talk about words.
Was that the input?
Was that the Oxford Dictionary?
He said that was. He may well be right. I was passing on what I had heard, and I'll, you know what I'll do for next week? I'll jot down a note to look that up and try to bring various dictionary definitions.
Bring in several definitions, yes. We're down to 6 minutes here, so if you want, and it is September 12th. We'll take the last few phone calls. Maybe one wants to call in with any other questions.
If I may mention something that I think atheists and theists would appreciate this quote,
and it is about atheism, which is why I wanted to talk about it.
Great.
But before I give you this quote, I want to give you a quote that everybody knows is from Theodore Roosevelt when he said, "There is nothing to fear but fear itself."
Right.
He actually took that from writing from Thoreau, but he left out a big part of the quote. Here's the quote from Thoreau. "Nothing is so much to be feared as fear. Atheism may comparatively be popular with God himself." And that's a pretty wild connection right there, and I thought that might be amusing.
Yes, I didn't know that that's where he got that from. That's very interesting. Want to welcome Arlo back. He's been gone for a couple weeks. I appreciate all the work you're doing there in the sound booth.
Thanks.
And our regular viewers might recognize the voice that he's back. And our sound, we're having music. We actually had a couple weeks there where we had no music. I see the lights are going, so as soon as we get a name here, we'll pass that along, and we'll try to get one more phone caller in. John Coons is going to be our next guest speaker. That's
right.
First Sunday in October. Like I say, he's a science teacher here in Austin, does a wonderful job. He's also our editor for our newsletter.
Right.
Does a fantastic...
And co-chair.
And he's also a co-chair. So, yes, he's definitely turned into quite an asset to our group. And like I say, I see one more name coming down the line. We'll try to get...
Oh.
Arvel?
Oh, hi.
Yes.
Good morning, Arvel.
How you guys doing?
Fantastic. Doing glad to see you calling the show. Yes.
Want to talk for a minute about something that's in the most recent Economist.
Sure.
It's a three-paragraph box thing, sort of making fun of Americans, really. They're talking about the reaction to the presidential candidates to the Kansas Board of Education. And all those present candidates are saying great things about not teaching evolution. And I guess the last comment was, excuse me, that they mentioned is from Gary Bauer. He says he rejects the basic tenets of that theory, and so do most Americans. And the last paragraph says he's right. According to Gallup polls, only 10% of Americans say they hold a secular evolutionist view of the world. Why, 44% believe in strict biblical creationism. And then here's the funny bit. 4 million also believe they've been abducted by aliens. The Economist urges candidates to address this vital question. Should schools teach survival courses for those threatened with aliens?
Great question, Arvo. Well, yes.
One of the interesting things there is... Christians often claim that the reason we ought to believe the Bible is that we have those eyewitness accounts going back to the old days.
Right.
And somehow I don't have much confidence in even those eyewitness accounts if I believe they really thought they saw what they were seeing, because we have 4 million people who think they've been abducted by aliens, and I don't put much credibility in that. And I guess you've seen those interviews with people who've seen flying saucers, who've seen aliens, who claim to have been abducted, and if you just listen to them, they sound, normal, convincing, everyday sort of event. And,
all right.
But I don't believe it.
Yeah, I don't either. Michael Shermer's book kind of put a lot of that to rest, why people believe weird things. Have you read that, Arvel?
No.
It's very good, and it talks about how many of these claims are made by people who get hypnotized, and they have these what is it called a reconstructed memory deal, and suddenly now I remember, after hypnosis and all this, that I had this abduction that I've always kind of fantasized about.
Repressed memories or something.
Yeah.
We had a caller earlier who was saying that what we need to do is we need to merge our rational thinking and our emotions, and that is exactly what we need to not do. What we need to do is have our rational thoughts looking at what our emotions are doing all the time, and not letting our emotions tell us what's true, because that's what your reason is for. Emotions are fine. Emotions give us impulses to do various things, which are sometimes good impulses and sometimes not. And we should be using our rational faculties to make that decision. These people that believe all this stuff are taking their emotional impressions and giving them the weight of factual information. And it just doesn't work that way, folks.
All right, Arvel, I got to go. We're running out of time.
Okay. We'll see you down at the bagel shop.
Thanks for your call.
Thanks for your call. All right, folks, we're down to 30. We're not going to take any more calls. I see the lights going up there. So if you're calling right now, call back next week. We're here every Sunday at 9 a.m., Channel 16. That was our voicemail. It was flashing up there earlier, 371-2911. We're heading down to the Hot Jumble Bakery once we leave here. It's down West 5th and Lavaca.
Oh, I love those special effects.
We love you, Austin. And I want to thank my crew. They do a fantastic job. They're down here every week behind the cameras. That's Arlo on the sound. Fantastic. That's great.